Clipper Audio presents an unabridged recording of Bubbles Unbound by Sarah Strohmeyer, narrated by Barbara McCulloh. This book is copyrighted 2001 by Sarah Strohmeyer. This recording is copyrighted 2003 by W.F. Howes Limited. It doesn't help that her name is Bubbles, or that she's a gum-snapping hairdresser with Barbie doll curves pinched into hot pants and a tube top, or that she's saddled with a sleazy ex-husband, a precocious daughter, and a shoplifting mom. So, what can a beautician do to add new highlights to her image? For starters, she can trip over a corpse and implicate a wealthy town socialite in a crime. And now, Bubbles Unbound.
Chapter 1. For most of my adult life, people in this town have passed me over as just another dumb blonde, fascinated by sex, soap operas, and gossip. My name, Bubbles Yablonsky, doesn't help matters any. Nor does the fact that my profession is hairdressing, my body resembles a Barbie doll's, and my fashion weaknesses are hot pants and tube tops. Okay, so I might not appear to be the brightest bulb in the vanity, but I know something even the police don't know. I know what really happened to Laura Buckman. Or at least I think I do. Like I told my boss and best friend, Sandy, 17-year-old cheerleaders as lively as Laura don't off themselves. Not here, in Lehigh, Pennsylvania. Lehigh is a no-nonsense, gritty steel town on the Jersey border. Here, we treat our cheerleaders with a reverence customarily reserved for minor saints. Here, the most important accessories a girl can wear are a homecoming crown on her head and a pom-pom in her hand. A cheerleader from Lehigh would be crazy to give that up. And Laura was not crazy. Foolish, maybe. Naive. Girlish, even reckless, but not crazy. I know, because I did her hair the day of the so-called suicide. That was 10 years ago. Sandy's House of Beauty, my place of employment, hasn't changed much since then. It is still a circa 1960 pink-walled hair salon located on the south side, 4 blocks from the maroon Lehigh steel blast furnaces, and right next door to Uncle Manny's Bar and Grill. This way, the men can grab a beer and watch a game at Manny's, while their wives get a comb and set at Sandy's. Many a Lehigh marriage has been saved by this arrangement. It's a pretty tight community of Poles, Slovaks, Germans, and Italians on the south side. Frowning babushkas keep their tidy homes spotless, right down to the sidewalk cracks they scrub with toothbrushes. Every porch has a red geranium for color and a green plastic welcome mat for wiping feet. Every door is decorated with cardboard hearts, leprechauns, or ghosts, depending on the nearest upcoming minor holiday. Every kitchen is filled with the spicy aroma of sausage and sauerkraut for dinner, which is served promptly at 5. Every woman over 40 gets her hair done at the House of Beauty. We do a big blue hair business at our salon, which is why the conversation stopped when Laura arrived as a walk-in that Friday morning in September, looking as cute as could be. She was wearing a bright white cheerleader's sweater, on which was embossed a big brown F. I assumed F stood for Freedom High School, known in our part of town as the Rich Kids School. Her wavy hair curled into a natural flip at her neck, and her overall demeanor was perky, perky, perky. Standing still, she was exhausting. Her hair, though, was a mess. Roots so dark, they screamed for immediate emergency highlights. Pronto. "Can you take me?" she asked, holding out a golden strand. "Honey," I replied, steering her toward my chair, "it'd be a violation of the stylist's code of ethics not to." I launched into a major discussion of treatment options. "Actually, I'm not looking for more highlights. I want to go black," she said, appraising herself in the mirror. "Jet black."
"Black?"
"Black like death." "Freedom cheerleaders go black like death, then?" In Lehigh, we often turn statements into questions by ending them with "then" or "say." Keeps the conversation going. "They do when they're singing backup." I warned Laura that once she went black, there was no turning back. She'd either have to keep it black or grow it out. "Do it," she said eagerly. I snapped a plastic apron around her shoulders, mixed the dye, Mediterranean night, with peroxide, and began squirting it over Laura's scalp, setting the timer for 30 minutes. In the meantime, I handed Laura a Diet A-Treat Cola. She kicked off her sneakers and relaxed, began to open up. I tend to have this effect on clients, especially women. They trust me with their most personal secrets, most of which center around how much they despise their in-laws or other clients at the salon. When they talk, I keep my mouth shut and my ears open. You'll get no judgment from Bubbles Yablonsky. Laura spent most of the wait raving about a garage band called Riders on the Storm and the to-die-for lead singer, who sounded to me like he was overdue for a turpentine scrub and rabies shots. Laura said she had a major crush on him and that, on the following night, he was going to play down at the Mill, an old hippie hangout by the park, once renowned for regular drug busts. He asked her to do vocals, hence the radical hairdo and her efforts to drop 5 pounds by Saturday. I rinsed out the dye with warm water. On her forehead, Mediterranean night left a thin line of black that I removed by rubbing it with cigarette ashes, an old hairdressing trick. "Your parents must like him, say?" I asked, knowing full well the answer to that one. "It's just my dad and me, and he's totally out of it because he's never home," she said, as I massaged shampoo behind her ears. "If he knew half the stuff that went on under his roof when he was out of town, he'd flip." Ding. Off went my internal maternal warning bell. I conditioned and rinsed her. Then I sat her up and wrapped a green towel around her head. "Like, what kind of stuff?" Laura hesitated. Could she confide in me? "Like all the parties," she said finally. "And friends of friends I hardly know who do it in his bed." Laura didn't explain further, and I didn't press. How many times have I regretted that? "She was slumming it, coming here to the House of Beauty, you know," observed Sandy, as we watched Laura step into her shiny, apple-red Honda Accord. "A gift from Daddy, no doubt. Kids on the South Side don't drive red Accords. The only red vehicles they drive are rusted. Probably she didn't want her regular beautician to get wind of her skipping school and singing backup down at the Mill," said I, the sudden voice of reason. I wonder. If you ask me, what that girl needs is a mother. The next day, Laura was dead. Her lifeless body was found behind her house on a chaise lounge in the pouring rain. It was all over the TV news, complete with special reports on the intense peer pressure facing today's cheerleaders, and shots of friends gathered on the Buckman's front lawn, hugging and crying. As Sandy rightly assumed, Laura Buckman was from the privileged side of town, near Camel Hump. She lived in a modern, cedar-sided house amidst crushed stone, trimmed hedges, and an in-ground swimming pool. None of the news reports mentioned her budding career as a groupie. the Buckman Central Party House, or the scummy boyfriend Rocksinger. The coroner was mum about the cause of death, except to say preliminary examinations pointed to suicide. Already, rumors were flying around town that Laura had killed herself with drug-laced Slimfast, a freshly blended pitcher of which was discovered in her refrigerator. "So that's why she didn't care about turning black," Sandy said. "She knew all along she wouldn't need a color correction." Sandy, who had obviously missed her calling as a nurse, handed me a cup of water to calm me down. She even looked like a nurse, from her neatly permed, short brown hair to her blue polyester uniform and sensible-soled floor shimes. "She didn't kill herself," I said, staring at the water. "Oh? And how do you know?" "A girl doesn't commit suicide right before singing backup for a guy she worships. At 17, you live for that." I could not understand why the police weren't more suspicious, too. It made me angry. "My question, Sandy, is why somebody doesn't care enough about this girl to at least look into the possibility that she was murdered." Sandy held up her hands in surrender. "Don't yell at me, Bubbles. Yell at the police. You know how they think. They think murders just don't happen on that side of town." That seemed like a stupid policy to me. So I put a call into the cops about Laura's last hair appointment. An overworked dispatcher took down the essentials and promised a response. I didn't hold out much hope, though. Lehigh's finest is essentially an oxymoron, and, as I predicted, the men in blue never stopped by. For the rest of the day, I obsessed about Laura's death. Twice, I left clients too long under the dryers so that their scalps turned the color of boiled lobster. Once, I nearly nicked off part of an ear. "You better go home early," Sandy said, picking up a pair of scissors I'd dropped for the fifth time that day. "Go get Dan the Man, that lame husband of yours, to wait on you for once." Dan the Man was not one of Sandy's favorite acquaintances. Sandy's low opinion of Dan stemmed from her fairly accurate observation that he treated me like soap scum. I put Dan through law school by shampooing days at the House of Beauty and waitressing nights at the Tally Ho Tavern after our daughter Jane was born. Jane's infancy was a blur of diapers and cream rinse, talcum and beer, thanks to him. And what did I get in return? Bupkis. No champagne, no roses, not even a thank you, Bubbles, for working two jobs so I could get a degree, note. I pointed out to Sandy that Dan was busting his butt at work these days, trying to make enough money to move us to the suburbs. 2 years earlier, we'd bought my childhood home, a brick row house on West Gep, from my mother, who was itching to live with her buddies at the brand new high-rise apartments on the east side of town. The house became nothing more than a cramp in Dan's style. He wanted wide green lawns, a media room, and landscaping. Our yard, the size of a postage stamp, was not cutting it for him. So I took Sandy's advice and went home early. I trudged up the steps of my cement front porch, let myself in with the key, and zeroed in on a black brassiere hanging from a living room lamp. "What are you doing home?" accused a pantsless Dan the Man, his Jolly Roger hoisted high and waving in the breeze. He jumped up from the couch and grabbed the brassiere to shield his private parts, as though I'd never seen them before. "Who's she?" asked a strange, nearly naked woman, splayed on my couch, wearing my terry cloth bathrobe. "Come back in 15 minutes, Bubbles," Dan instructed, glancing at a brand new Rolex. "We're just finishing up." And I was finished with my thoughtless, ungrateful pig of a husband. Sandy was right. Dan treated me like dirt. It took no time at all for my high-heeled pumps to deliver a swift kick to Dan's jewels. And I don't mean the Rolex. As for the homewrecker, I popped her collagen-filled red lips with a neat right hook. Dan was so incensed by my reaction, he packed up and left that night, for good. Dummy that I am, it hadn't occurred to me that Dan's plans to get out of West Gep Street never included me and Jane in the first place. "You gotta take action," Sandy advised that night, as we gathered around my kitchen table for a private pity party of Newport Lights and Bartles and James. "You're too good a person to have to suck this up, Bubbles. You have to get back at Dan. You gotta make him pay." "I gotta get more education, like Dan did. You gotta be someone Jane can look up to. I gotta find out who killed Laura Buckman." Sandy tapped an ash. "It's a tall order. How are you gonna do it?" But I was barely listening. My mind was running over the day, from Laura's supposed suicide to Dan's infidelity. And from the recesses of my supposedly vapid brain bubbled up the absurd notion that the two events were somehow connected. I later discovered that my hunches about Laura's murder were correct, and that, yes, indeed, there was a connection between her and my ex-husband. Unfortunately for me, though, a group of Lehi's most powerful elite was determined to keep the circumstances of her death a secret, even if that meant permanently silencing those who uncovered the truth. And Bubbles Yablonsky was no exception. Over the next 10 years, Laura Buckman's visit and death became a distant, albeit haunting, memory. Between the divorce and raising Jane, I had other recreations, like inventing schemes to wreak revenge on Dan, none of which worked very well. Then Providence tossed me a bone when Dan made the foolish mistake of asking the court if he could stop paying me the whopping $150 a month in alimony. Now, $150 a month doesn't sound like much to pay an ex-wife who put you through law school, especially if you are a promising lawyer such as Dan. But money wasn't the issue. Getting me out of his life was. To understand why, it helps to understand Lehi. Lehi is a town of haves and have-nots. The haves are steel executives and their families, who inhabit well-groomed developments north of the river. The men play golf at the Greenbrier Country Club, where the women, who tend to be genetically adept at growing perennials, play tennis 3 days a week. Once a year, the company flies the whole family to a beachfront resort in North Carolina for the annual executive physical, or to South America on the pretense of checking out copper mines. Full-time maids are not uncommon. I, on the other hand, am a poster girl for the have-nots. We live south of the river, in brick row houses. Most men in our class work in the dirty, dangerous steel mills, where blast furnaces and coke ovens radiate suffocating heat. On the weekends, we shoot pool, go bowling, and drink Rolling Rock. Each summer, we hit the boardwalk at Wildwood, New Jersey, and eat fried dough with powdered sugar on the beach. It's pretty simple. What the haves have, we, the have-nots, don't. Dan desperately wanted to be a have. He was so desperate that despite his love of cabbage rolls and the World Wrestling Federation, he decided to try and pass himself off as a wasp after our divorce. He went full Biff, bow ties, Brooks Brothers suits, preppy nickname. Even dyed his hair a yachting sandy blonde. To his credit, Dan made tremendous inroads into this world by marrying Wendy Hawkman. While Wendy was no Princess Diana, she was the heiress of the Hawkman's Cheeseballs empire. In marrying Wendy, Dan set himself up with bucks, beer nuts, and bright orange cheese doodles for life. Every man's dream. However, Dan still worked for a slip-and-fall law firm that advertised on the cardboard insert of Yellow Pages that they don't get paid until you get paid. Most of Wendy's country club friends were appalled, frankly, that Dan's clientele relied on bail bondsmen to spare them temporary incarceration. Dan determined that what he needed was a corporate legal job. What he needed was to sever any ties to his working-class past, including me, a Polish-German-American embarrassment, who barely squeaked through beauty school at Northampton County Votech. At the alimony hearing, the judge agreed with Dan about the $150 a month. However, the judge ruled that, seeing as how I had put Dan through law school, it was only fair that he should pay for my continuing education. Dan coughed back a smile like a naughty boy caught stealing a cookie. He'd read my high school transcript. I walked up to him after court and tapped him on the shoulder. I don't know what's come over me, Skippy. I suddenly got a burning desire for knowledge. I'll alert Harvard, he replied, clicking shut his gray calfskin briefcase. And you got it wrong, as usual. It's Chip, not Skip. The very next day, I showed up at the doorstep of the local community college, which is run out of an abandoned Two Guys department store. I was interested to read in the community college brochure that there'd been a small hike in tuition recently, to $500 per course. I took almost every course the community college had to offer. Accounting, business, Chrysler dealer apprenticeship, entrepreneurship, funeral service provider, medical transcriber, plastics, welding, animal cosmetology. You name it, I studied it. And failed it. Bombed. Flunked. The big goose egg. 6 years of community college down the tubes. I'm a hard worker, and I try. I'm just not very strong in the academic department, especially when all I had to lose was Dan's money. $18,000 of which I'd managed to misplace. Give it up, Bubbles, advised my weary guidance counselor with the office in aisle 5, sheets and towels. Stick to hairdressing. I was about to take her advice and call it quits when my life took a sudden turn for the worse. All our clients started getting their weekly comb and sets at Cuts for Less in the brand new Lehigh Valley Mall. My tips dropped off dramatically, and I was strapped for cash. There was no way I could be disloyal to Sandy and work at Cuts for Less. And there was no way I could stay with the House of Beauty and survive. My savings account contained just enough money to pay a minor repair bill on my Camaro. My Visa tin card had hit its $3,000 max, and I wasn't sleeping very well. To make matters worse, Jane was beginning to notice our precarious financial status. Everything in this house is generic, she observed one night at dinner. We have generic toilet paper, generic soda, generic coffee, even generic mac and cheese. How much does that cost? 39 cents? I winced. Actually, it's a quarter, with an in-store double coupon at ShopRite. Oh, Mom, she clucked sympathetically. I don't mean to bum you out. I know you kill yourself to make ends meet. You can't help it if you're always down on your luck. I nearly broke a plate. Geesh, I didn't want my daughter to think of me as always down on my luck, especially since her dad was dining on black Angus steak and Perrier these days. Jane was completely unaware that Dan's new fortune was not his own. All she knew was that his 15-room suburban palace and Eddie Bauer SUV made her life with me look desolate. I got the impression she was wondering what was wrong with her lazy, loafing mother. What kind of loser lives in the same rundown house she grew up in, buys generic hot dogs, and flunks every course at the community college? Don't get me wrong. Jane isn't a bad kid. She's a great kid. Sure, she owes her hair color to the magic of Kool-Aid, which she washes into her hair nightly. Other than that, you can't find a nicer or funnier 16-year-old. Or smarter. Member of the Liberty High School math team. President of the debating club. And that was another thing. College. How was I going to pay for Jane's college? This is why I needed a new career. It was either that, or give up altogether, go on welfare, and beg for scholarships. No, Yablonsky's going to go on welfare, and that's final, pronounced my mother, Lulu, when I picked her up to take her to my house for Sunday chicken. What? You think your grandfather fled Gdansk and escaped the Soviets just so's we could move to America and live off the state like commies? I should slap you upside the head for that talk. There was no getting around Lulu Yablonsky. She might have the stature of a circus midget and the figure of a pickle barrel. She might brew dandelion beer in the bathtub and play the boombas past dawn. But she was 4 feet, 5 inches of pure power. If Lulu said no, then no it was. So I headed back to the department store community college, this time with solemn promises that I would pass my courses, whatever courses were left to take. My guidance counselor heaved a sigh and suggested journalism. Journalism? I asked. What's journalism? Perhaps we ought to forget it. She put the forms back in the drawer. I grabbed her wrist. Please, give me a chance. Okay, but we're at the end of the line, Bubbles. Flunk this, and the only course left is taxidermy. Stuffed squirrels? Ugh. Journalism, whatever it was sounding better and better. Well, I eventually found out what journalism was, and I'm pleased to say I was a natural. Because when you combine all that asking, snooping, investigating, not to mention the who, what, where, when, and why stuff that reporting requires, it comes down to one word. Gossip. And gossip is how a neighborhood hairdresser like me earns her bread and butter. After years and years in the beauty biz, my sympathetic ear was superbly trained for human tragedy. Take the time our journalism class took a field trip to the Northampton County Courthouse to watch a trial. I missed the trial because I ended up in the courthouse bathroom comforting a sobbing woman. It took me almost an hour of commiserating and an entire roll of Charmin to calm her down. When she finally got hold of herself, she confessed that she was racked with guilt because her boyfriend had been charged with murdering her good-for-nothing abusive husband when it had been she who'd shot the SOB all along. By the end of the day, she agreed to turn herself in and provide me with an interview. An exclusive interview, I might add. Have to hand it to you, Yablonsky, said my journalism professor, Mr. Salvo. You got the knack. I beamed with pride. I mean, Mr. Salvo was more than just a journalism professor. He was also night editor of the News Times, the Lehigh Valley's largest newspaper. Night editor for 20 years. And looked it, too. Thin white skin and tiny eyes like a mole. Unfortunately, while Mr. Salvo had the authority to sign me freelance articles, he couldn't hire reporters full-time down at the paper. Only the editor-in-chief, Dix Notch, could do that, Mr. Salvo said. And Notch ordinarily required 2 years' experience at a smaller newspaper before he'd look at a resume. Like I even had a resume. Ha! I can't wait 2 years, Mr. Salvo, I whined. I need another job now. A good job. A career. Mr. Salvo poured himself a cup of coffee from his thermos. Why the rush? I explained about my cash situation and the House of Beauty. How I wanted to make Jane proud of her mother, so she wouldn't think of me as some down-on-her-luck sad sack. How I wanted to send her to college, and maybe even move off West Gep Street. Mr. Salvo stroked his nearly hairless chin and pondered this. What you need, Yablonsky, is a big break. A story so gripping, Notch will waive the 2-year requirement and hire you on the spot. You know, since the News Times got bought by Garnett Corporation, we pay better than most newspapers our size. How much better? Starting reporter like yourself? I'd say $35,000 plus stock options, full benefits including dental, and 2 weeks vacation. I imagined how Jane would react if she heard that I was a staff writer for the News Times with stock options, 2 weeks vacation, and dental. Mr. Salvo, how do I get a big break? If I knew that, Yablonsky, he said, patting my shoulder, I wouldn't be teaching at a community college run out of some bankrupt department store, now would I? I continued to slog away down at the House of Beauty, picking up meager tips here and there. I finished Mr. Salvo's course with a 4.0 and accepted as many freelance assignments as I could from him. I wrote about spelling bees and historical society meetings, mistreatment of racing greyhounds, and how to avoid Lyme disease, blood shortages and storm damage, strawberry picking, and 4th of July reunions of immigrant families. But as I stepped over squished strawberries and petted anorexic, and often flatulent, greyhounds, I couldn't help wondering if this was all just a waste of effort. What made me think that I, Bubbles Yablonsky, hairdresser, would ever come across a story important enough to be the big break? I had no idea at the time that Laura Buckman's death was the key to the biggest story to hit Lehigh in a decade, or that I, and I alone, had heard the most significant clue to her murder. It took me an unexpected telephone call, one mutilated body, and a series of misadventures to realize that. Mr. Salvo calls this my big break, but I prefer to think of it as Laura Buckman reaching out to me from the grave. Like I said, women tell their hairdressers the deepest, darkest secrets. Chapter 2. It's for you, Bubbles, Sandy announced, pushing the mute button on the portable phone. Some nutcase. Sounds frantic. A frantic nutcase sounded a lot better right now than finishing the perm on Mrs. Sinclair. Mrs. Sinclair was on a serious fishing expedition to find out who my mother was dating at the senior center. It's a competitive game, being a widow. Even Mama's been known to cruise by funerals, looking to pick up fresh meat. If Lulu had someone on the hook, Mrs. Sinclair wanted to know who it was and what bait she used. Did I mention that your mother's bought a bikini? Mrs. Sinclair called after me as I skipped over to get the phone. Do you think it might be Carl Johnson? He's not bad, even if he's got only one eye. I shuddered at the thought of Mama making it with a one-eyed geezer and punched the mute button. Bubbles Yablonsky. Bubbles, we got an emergency. It was Mr. Salvo, and Sandy was right. He sounded more hyper than an overbred poodle at the vet. I got a jumper and no staff. Can you cover? Excuse me? He took a deep breath. Got a guy 10 blocks from your hair salon on the Fahey Bridge about to jump. Came across the scanner a few minutes ago. Being a Friday evening, I've got no reporters to send. They're either out on assignment, on vacation, or taking an early weekend at the shore. I couldn't blame them. It was the first week in August, and, although late in the day, still a muggy 89 degrees. I'd be at the shore, too, if I could afford it. The Lehigh Valley is no place to swelter in the dog days of summer. What do you want me to do, Mr. Salvo? Mrs. Sinclair was beginning to take out the pink-papered rollers herself. Just the basics. But be alert. I heard the cops talking. It's a father of three, schoolteacher. Lots of human interest. Page one, definitely, if he jumps. Mr. Salvo made it sound like more a hope than a possibility. I scanned the day planner on which Sandy had scrawled down appointments in various colors of ink. After Mrs. Sinclair, Susan Saladunas came in at 6:30. Late, because she runs a fish market with her husband, and Friday is their busiest day. Sandy would take her. I was free to knock off after Mrs. Sinclair. Out of the corner of my eye, I caught Sandy waving her hands. Go, she mouthed. This could be the big break. Anyway, Mrs. Sinclair was down to the last paper. I'll do it, I said. Great. A friend of mine from New York is staying with me for the weekend and happens to be an AP photographer. I managed to talk him into shooting this as a favor. You can meet him at the opposite side of the bridge by the city center. Since they got this side... Mr. Salvo? I interrupted. I got a bit of a problem. No car. In the shop? I didn't want to admit that the Camaro was parked in my neighbor's garage with a glove compartment full of bright yellow parking tickets. I'd forgotten about them until I received a kindly letter in the mail reminding me that if I didn't pay the $145 to the city of Lehigh, I'd be put on the boot list. That sum seemed a little unfair, so I threw away the letter and occasionally hid my car on private property. I've racked up so many tickets, the meter maids carry around pictures of my license plate in their wallets. It's just out of commission. Okay, I'll have Stiletto pick you up. Who? The photographer, and... That's another thing, Yablonsky. About Stiletto. He's kind of... I began rummaging around the desk drawer for a good pen and a decent tablet. Kind of what? Gruff? Mean? Crude? Wow. I can tell you got a good impression of men. No, it's more like... You ever hear of the story of Ulysses and the sirens on the rocks? I rolled my eyes. Nerdy bookworms. Not what I need when I'm trying to take care of a client and get my sorry carcass over to a bridge jumper. Sounds vaguely familiar. Well, that's what it's like for women with Stiletto. At least, from what I've observed. Mrs. Sinclair had removed all the rollers and was sitting with a bright pink cloud of papers in her lap. Her toe was tapping on the footrest expectantly. Can we get to the point, Mr. Salvo? My client... Just bind yourself to the mast, Yablonsky, when you're around Stiletto. Okay? Keep yourself bound, no matter what. I muttered a quick goodbye and hung up the phone. If anyone needed a trip to the shore, it was Mr. Salvo. Obviously, the heat had cooked his brain. You going out on a story, Bubbles? Mrs. Sinclair asked, as I combed out her dyed ash-blonde curls. What woman is born a natural ash-blonde? No woman. Especially not 62-year-old women like Mrs. Sinclair. I filled her in about the jumper, grateful, at least, that we had moved the conversation off Mama's erratic behavior. Maybe you'll see Mickey. He's working today from 3 to midnight. When Mrs. Sinclair wasn't analyzing the sexual affairs of her peers, she was boasting about her police officer son, Mickey. I threw the comb in a drawer and shut it with my hip. It's amazing that you've memorized his work schedule like that. Oh, I haven't. He calls me every morning at 8 on the spot and lets me know where he'll be. Calls me before bedtime, too. Unless it's late. Sandy flashed me a knowing look. Mama's boy. Hey, Bubbles, Sandy said. I got a dress hanging in the back if you want to wear it. Why would I want to do that? I thought. I checked the reflection of myself spraying Mrs. Sinclair's hair with a heavy coat of final net. My golden blonde hair was piled on my head under a bright pink chiffon kerchief, which coordinated nicely with the magenta halter top and black spandex hot pants. What was the problem? You think I ought to change? Before Sandy could answer, we heard the crunch of gravel on the street and three long honks. Sandy pried open the Venetian blinds with two fingers and peeked outside. Is someone coming to pick you up? I removed the plastic cape from around Mrs. Sinclair's neck and brushed her off. Yeah, the photographer. Is that him? They say anything about him being Mel Gibson's twin brother? I gulped. Mrs. Sinclair hopped out of the chair like a bunny and flew to the window, yanking up the blinds. Holy Mary, Mother of God, she whispered, crossing herself. To be 22 again. Honk, honk, honk. I opened the bottom drawer of my vanity and removed my purse, putting a tablet and pen inside. He might be good looking, but he sure is rude, I said, yanking open the door. Whatever happened to the days when men picked girls up at the door? Sandy grabbed me by the arm. Remember, Bubbles. Remember how you are when it comes to sex, she warned. Keep your knees locked. I shook her hand off. Geez, Sandy, I'm not 19. Boy, the respect I get. Sure, I was careless about sex when I was a teenager, letting Dan knock me up at age 17 being a case in point. How I ever allowed myself to get pinned to a Lehigh University fraternity floor by a dorky freshman with two beer cans strapped to either side of his head is a mystery I'll never solve. At least I got Jane in the deal. Besides, that was a long time ago. I was in high school then. Now I'm 34. More mature. Sophisticated. I know what I want, and I'm willing to hold out for it. I am woman. Hear me. The door to the House of Beauty slammed behind me, and I stopped still. A tanned man, who appeared to be in his mid-30s, sat in the driver's side of a black Jeep, top down, with white New York State license plates. His brown hair was longish, but not too long, and his tanned face was creased in all the right places, like he just finished a tough day in the sun rounding up cattle on a ranch. I couldn't tell what color his eyes were, because they were masked by a pair of very dark, very expensive Ray-Bans. Sandy's warning to keep my knees locked suddenly seemed inadequate. What I needed was a deadbolt, preferably one without a key. Enough about the face. The body, or what I could see of it, was what really caught my attention. Specifically, biceps that strained his gray t-shirt and a broad pair of shoulders that begged for a massage. Either he had worked very hard on perfecting this image, in which case I would have to slap him around a bit, or he came by it naturally, thereby requiring me to jump him on the spot. Both ways were trouble. You Yablinko? He asked. Yablonsky, I corrected. God damn, it's hot, he said, turning the key and starting up the Jeep. Let's get going. I need some breeze. I was about to give him a lecture on the importance of etiquette, like ringing a doorbell, opening a car door, etc., etc. But thought better of it. Why waste my energy on that now? This guy was a project. A long-term project, I could tell. Months, if not years. As soon as I was in the car, Stiletto stepped on the gas, and we headed up 4th Street. A canvas camera bag, frayed at the edges, lay on the floor, crowding my feet. I gently kicked it aside. "Watch that!" He pointed to the bag. "There's $11,000 worth of equipment in there." What'd you say your name is?" "Bubbles," I said. Stiletto held his hand up to his right ear. "What? I'm kind of hard of hearing after the shelling in Bosnia." I leaned toward his ear and shouted, "Bubbles! Bubbles Yablonsky!" "Jesus Christ, woman! I'm not stone deaf." He gave his head a violent shake. "My name's Steve Stiletto. Like the knife." "Or like the heel," I said, adding quickly, "You were in Bosnia?" "Yeah, 3 years. For the Associated Press." He shifted into third, and we took the corner on two wheels, headed in the wrong direction. "Mr. Salvo said they blocked off that end of the bridge, so we should go over the hill to Hillbridge and approach from the city center side," I yelled, out of sensitivity for that auditory problem of his. Stiletto ignored me and kept on going. "Didn't you hear me?" I screamed. "I heard you. This is a shortcut." I thought of those New York license plates. "Listen, I've lived in this town my whole life," I said, "and I know my way around the South Side." "Whoo-wee. You steel town girls think you're so tough, don't you? Know it all, seen it all, done it all. By the way, you always dress that way on the job?" I quickly assessed my hot pants. "You got a complaint?" Stiletto grinned and did one of those furtive up-and-down glances men pull when they're trying to evaluate a woman's breasts. "Not exactly a complaint," he said. "More like a curiosity." Aha! Stiletto was one of those men who thought I dressed this way for men. Well, if that was the case, then he was sadly mistaken. I dressed this way for me. It's a medical fact that my body won't accept cotton or wool, or drab colors for that matter. They make me itchy and depressed. I don't feel comfortable in anything that's not tight or stretchy or short. And if Stiletto, or any other man, doesn't like it, then he can jolly well keep his mind on baseball. "You better treat me with respect," I warned. "We hairdressers own $400 scissors that can cut off a person's lips." "Ouch," he said. We zoomed down 4th Street, past a line of aluminum-sided white houses, the Elks Club Local 549, a pool hall, St. Sylvester's Church and Rectory, Our Lady of Redemption, a pizza parlor, and two red lights. Stiletto took a sharp right and then a left onto 3rd Street, which was lined on one side by Lehigh Steel, hidden behind mammoth black iron gates. He went one block and turned into a steel employee's parking lot, shifting the Jeep into neutral and pulling up the brake. "What are you doing?" I asked, as he hopped out and talked to a guard in a little booth. The guard nodded, and Stiletto shook his hand. Then Stiletto got back in the Jeep, and we zipped across a parking lot filled with American-made cars. We headed toward the back of a warehouse. "Are you crazy? Do you have any idea where you're going? I mean, you're not even from around here." "I'm from around here, all right," he said, as we drove down a narrow road that ran between a line of rust-red warehouses and the railroad track, which paralleled the Lehigh River. "I grew up in this town." I studied him again. I'd never seen Steve Stiletto in my life, and I knew practically everyone in Lehigh. "Where'd you go to high school?" I must admit, I'm not as familiar with people who went to Freedom High School, being a downtown Liberty High girl myself. Moravian Academy, then Andover, Exeter. Got kicked out of there, finally, thank God. Took me long enough. I'd never heard of Andover and Exeter. Those in Allentown? Stiletto leaned over and patted my knee. You're cute, Bubbles. I frowned. We left the line of warehouses and loading docks and arrived at the point where the railroad tracks disappear under the Philip J. Fahey Bridge. Even from this vantage point, we could see that the bridge above us had been evacuated except for several white police cruisers, ambulances, and flashing blue lights. The wind was picking up, and black clouds were gathering in the sky. There'd been a thunderstorm every evening since this heat wave began. You'd expect the rain to cool things off, but it only made the humidity worse, and sleeping sticky. Stiletto pulled the jeep next to the railroad tracks and killed the engine. He leaned under me and yanked out the camera bag. "Let's go," he said, getting out. I followed him and brought the strap of my purse over my head so that it crossed my body. I had the feeling that whatever Stiletto had in mind, it was going to require sneaking, climbing, and sweating. "What I suggest," he said, zipping open the camera bag, "is that we take the footbridge to Jefferson Park and the stairs up to the bridge. The cops will never let us get close to the jumper otherwise." Jefferson Park is a small island in the middle of the Lehigh River. Back in the 1950s, when people were clean and wholesome, city officials decided to put a tennis court on the island and steps up to the bridge. It was a nice idea, until drug dealers co-opted it for their business 20 years later. To cut down on crime, the island's been closed to the public since the Reagan administration. "Can you manage in those heels?" Stiletto asked. I examined my feet, on which were strapped a pair of high-heeled black plastic sandals. "I could cross the Sahara in these heels." "Not like you weren't warned." Stiletto led the way, taking long strides over the railroad tracks and down the gravel bank to the Lehigh River. From there, we walked across a crumbling cement footbridge to the park, which was inconveniently barricaded by a 6-foot-high chain-link fence. The grass was overgrown, and the netless red clay tennis courts were covered with weeds, broken brown glass, and faded soda cans. Stiletto strolled along the side of the fence until he came to a hole some juvenile delinquent had cut for no good reason. I tripped after him, my heels sinking into the ground along the way. We crossed the tennis courts and stood at the foot of metal stairs leading to the Fahey. With the traffic detoured, it was eerily silent. The bridge loomed huge and high, supported by massive steel beams around which fluttered a few gray pigeons. "My best shot's probably going to be right there," he said, pointing to a beam that ran crosswise from the top of the stairs underneath the bridge. "If I can crawl to the end of that beam, I'll probably be right below the action, which is a lot better than shooting a picture of some cops standing around waiting for a guy to jump." "Where are all the other reporters?" Stiletto screwed a lens onto the camera. "Unless they did what we're going to do, they're killing time at the police barricades at the end of the bridge. Not my style, honey bunch." I glanced at him, at the beam, and then at him again. "What do you mean, what we're going to do? I did not fancy the idea of hanging my derriere 100 feet over water." "You should climb the stairs and try your luck on the bridge. The cops won't let you get within 20 feet of the guy, but if you keep your mouth shut, they might let you stay. Seeing as you're braless." Stiletto pushed down his Ray-Bans and winked at me. I folded my arms across my chest. Maybe the cops have a point, I offered. You know, with it being a prospective suicide and... But Stiletto was already stealthily climbing to the top. Even in this nerve-wracking situation, I couldn't help noticing how nicely his perfectly worn jeans stretched across his trim behind and outlined the muscles of his thighs. Thank you, God, I whispered, for giving me such charming co-workers. Now, the question was whether I was going to be half as courageous as Stiletto. I needed a big break, and I was never going to get it if I stuck to greyhounds and spelling bees. I slipped off my high-heeled sandals, stuck them in my purse, and grabbed the stair railings. Those heels never would have made it over the steel mesh. In no time, Stiletto was at the beam. He turned, gave me a wave, and tucked his head. I saw him put down one hand, and then a knee, and crawl into the shadows under the bridge. His camera hung from a strap around his neck. I had to turn away. Him dangling like that over the water made my palms sweat. I got to the top of the stairs and glanced down. Below me, the trash-strewn tennis courts were the size of coasters. Above me, I could hear a scanner squawking from a police cruiser, right near where I was standing. I took a deep breath. There was no thrill for me in the prospect of arriving unannounced and unwelcome at some high-tension suicide scene patrolled by cops and firemen. Stiletto was pushing me too hard. He might be used to Bosnia and creeping behind enemy lines, but I was new to this hard-news reporting shtick. Why couldn't I wait for word at the police barricades like all the other reporters? Why did I have to stick my neck out like this? It crossed my mind to defy Stiletto, climb down the stairs, and do what was right and proper. Then I thought of the $35,000 salary and the big break and what Jane would say if I told her that I had enough guts to crash a police scene in order to get a story. She'd be floored. I closed my eyes and popped my head over the top of the stairs. Stop right there, a voice barked. Don't take another step. I opened my eyes and nearly fell backward to my death. Staring me in the face was Mickey Sinclair and the black barrel of a police pistol. Oh, for heaven's sake! Put that gun away, Mickey, I scolded. I just finished a perm on your mother 5 minutes ago. What would she say if she could see you pointing a gun at me? Mickey Sinclair stared at me like I was Godzilla in drag, which was ridiculous, since Mickey and I had gone through William Penn Elementary together. Back in first grade, he used to entertain the girls by snorting green jello up his nose in the cafeteria. Now he was a police detective with 5 kids. I'd heard it all from his mother. He hadn't changed much in the interim. Still had the string bean body and the satellite dishes for ears. Bubbles? Mickey squinted, putting the gun back in his hip holster. Bubbles Yablonsky? What in Sam Crow are you doing here? I squeezed around the bridge railing and stepped behind the cruiser, safely hidden from the other cops. I leaned down and slipped my sandals back on. Mickey's jaw hung open. Since he was a congenital mouth breather, that was to be expected. I'm doing a story for the News Times, I whispered. Mickey shook his head. You got to be kidding. Aren't you still a hairdresser down at Sandy's place? We prefer the term stylist. Anyway, I've been freelancing for months. Don't you read the paper? Sure, the sports section. So, where's Lawless? He usually covers these things. Lawless was the News Times veteran cop reporter. From what I understood, the cops loved him like one of their own, although in the newsroom he had the reputation for being chronically lazy. I peered around the hood of the cruiser, trying to get a better view of the jumper, who was standing at the edge of the bridge, opposite us. "Beats me where Lawless is," I said. "Who's the jumper?" Mickey, apparently sufficiently recovered from the shock of seeing me, mere hairdresser at a police scene, said, "You're not going to believe it. Remember Mr. Dudko from 11th grade physics? It's him." "No way. Mr. D?" I stuck my neck out for a closer look. I couldn't make out much. A squat man with a balding head wearing a short-sleeved baby blue polyester dress shirt. When he turned briefly, I spotted the outline of a pocket protector in his upper left-hand pocket. That was Mr. Dudko, all right. A woman with gray hair in a bun, thick horn-rim glasses, and a long brown skirt was earnestly talking to him over the edge of the bridge railing. "Who's the frump?" I asked. "A psychologist," Mickey answered, scratching one of his oversized ears. "Not having much luck, though. I think Dudko is really going to do it. The school board told him today that they were buying out his contract, 'cause his students' test scores were the pits. He's been crying about his 30-year career wasted, or some such crap." "That was hogwash." "Sure, I didn't learn anything in Mr. Dudko's class either. Nobody did. That didn't make him a bad teacher. Physics is just a bad subject, irrelevant to everyday life. What Mr. Dudko needed was an Oprah-style pep talk, a shot of good old-fashioned self-esteem." "Hey, Mr. D," I shouted, waving my hand. "Over here." "Cripes, Bubbles," Mickey said under his breath. "You'll get hauled out." Mr. D turned in my direction. The late afternoon sun glinted off his trademark steel-frame glasses. "Who's she?" the psychologist demanded loudly. I cupped my hands to my mouth. "It's me, Bubbles Yablonsky." Two cops in dark blue uniforms started walking up the bridge to get me, their faces set in deep scowls. "Don't you remember? Bubbles, the gum chewer." Mickey grabbed me by the elbow and led me around the cruiser. I thought for sure Mr. D would remember me. Every day, at the door to his physics class, he'd hold out his palm and ask me to deposit the juicy fruit. We kind of had a bond, albeit a wet, sticky bond. I must have been mistaken, because Mr. Dudko took up a conversation with a psychologist instead. Now I was being led down the bridge by Mickey and the two cops. Well, I'd taken a chance. At least I'd tried. "Stop!" It was the psychologist. "He wants to talk to her." My heart did a little quick step. The cops mumbled something and turned me around. I click, click, clicked in my high-heeled black sandals back up the bridge. When I got to where Mr. Dudko was standing, I was blown away. The late afternoon sun lit up the Lehigh River below us and turned the steel factories on the left bank a coppery red. To the right, the storm clouds billowed black and threatening. Directly ahead, the old hill-to-hill bridge, with its salt-and-pepper shaker towers, connected the south side to the historic section of Lehigh. I'd never stood at the edge of the Fahey Bridge on a summer evening before a storm. The city should run tour buses. "Wow," I exclaimed. "The view up here is terrific." "Oh, for Pete's sake," said the psychologist. "Come over here, Bubbles," said Mr. Dudko in a shaky voice. I tiptoed closer. He looked like the same old Mr. D. His comb-over was a little grayer, and seeing as he was preparing to off himself, it made sense that the sweat stains in his armpits were a little larger. All in all, the same old Captain Physics from high school. Passed me with a D-minus, God bless him. "I mean closer. Come on, Mr. Dudko waved me nearer.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.